us direction from above. We need a word from the Lord. A word from the Lord.
Is to remind us what a brother keepers, we as brother keepers, believe. And if Brian would get ready to push that button.
Well, call somebody else.
Y'all always pose the question, am I my brother's keeper? And the movement gets its start from Genesis chapter 4, verses 2 through 9. And can anybody tell me what happened in that text?
Cain slew Abel, and God asked him where his brother was, and he decided to answer the question with, am I my brother's keeper?
The obvious answer to that question should have been,
yes, I am.
It should have been, yes, I am. But because of jealousy, and because he wasn't willing to turn from sin, as God says, sin is crouching at your door, he slew his brother.
Mm.
And it's dangerous for men, especially Christian men, to be jealous of their brothers.
Well,
that's right. Come on.
And God's kingdom work can't go forward if we are jealous of one another.
Well,
yep.
So from that text, we learn three core principles in which we, as we pose this question, am I my brother's keeper? The first one, if Brian would keep pushing the button.
Okay.
You pose the question, am I my brother's keeper? The first thing we see, as Brian keeps pushing the button, is an MBK keeps Christ first. If God would have been first in his life, he wouldn't have slew his brother, because he would have done what he should have done and given the sacrifice to God in the way that God should be worshipped, basically. And we turn this terminology into New Testament. Back in the Old Testament, it was God. For us, it's Christ. The second thing that MBK believes is that we keep confession at the forefront. If he would have confessed his sin before God, God would have forgiven him.
Well,
that's right.
And that shows us the importance of confessing our sin. And I like to pose a question. Has anybody here arrived yet?
Well,
if you haven't arrived, then there should be confession every day.
Right.
Every day.
Amen.
There should be confession.
Amen.
Lord, I blew it today. Lord, I didn't speak right to my wife or my kids or my workers. Lord, I blew it today. And when we confess our sins before God, he will forgive us of our sins. And
yes,
then we can be in right fellowship with our brothers.
That's right.
And the third principle of my brother's keeper is that we keep caring for our families. That was his brother.
Mm.
Can you imagine?
Well.
And when we first started this movement, I asked a question about your brothers. You who have brothers. And some said, no, I never wanted to kill him. I wanted to hurt him. But the MBK keeps caring for his family.
Right.
And as men, we care not only for our brothers, but for our wives.
Yeah.
Amen.
Those
sure.
of us
right.
who are married, we treat her as Christ loved the church.
That's right.
That's the model that we have for loving our wives, which means that we are the ones that are to do most of the sacrificing in our relationships.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So am I my brother's keeper?
Yes, I am.
Am I my brother's keeper?
Yes, I am.
Am I my brother's keeper?
Yes, I am.
Amen, and praise the Lord. So this is what we believe today. We're going to go into a message really that was kind of motivated from the headlines as Brian keeps pushing the button. We're going to talk about the perils of an unfaithful man. And we're going to be looking at Judges 14 verses 1 through 2 as well as 16 verses 1 through 4. And again, we're going to talk about the perils of an unfaithful man. Many of you have heard what's been going on in the news today. I don't want to name names because I really don't have any stones to throw.
That's right.
But it was some very surprising actions that happened, because this person had a real squeaky clean image.
Yeah.
And it was surprising to me, not only that he had this lifestyle into which he confessed through a press release that he had some transgressions in his life. It was very surprising, and the only reason I can say that it's so surprising is that he had a squeaky clean image. He wasn't a preacher like I am, or even claimed to be a man of God. But this happened to him, and he's going to lose some things because of his actions and behavior. Again, like I said, I don't have any thrones to throw, but I thought that this could be a real good teachable moment for Christian men.
Yeah, come on now.
For Christian men. I thought this would be a time for us to encourage our brothers to be faithful to our wives. And when we're faithful to our wives, we are faithful to our children. But if we're going to be faithful to our wives and our children, first of all, we have to be faithful to our God.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
That's why on the back of the t-shirts, we keep Christ first. 01 on the back of the t-shirts means that God has the number one spot in my life.
Yeah.
But we're going to learn from the life of Samson the perils of an unfaithful man. Let's read this together. It's three slides. And let's read this together on three. One, two, three.
Samson went down to Timnah and saw there a young Philistine woman. When he returned, he said to his father and mother, "I have seen a Philistine woman in Timnah. Now get her for me as my wife." One day Samson went to Gaza, where she saw a prostitute. He went in to spend the night with her. The people of Gaza were told, "Samson is here." So they surrounded the place and lay in wait for him all night at the city gate. They made no move during the night, saying, "At dawn, we'll kill him." Sometime later, he fell in love with a woman in the Valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah.
The rulers of the Philistines went to her and said, "See if you can lure him into showing you the secret of his great strength,
and how we can overpower him so we may tie him up and subdue him. Each one was of will give him 100 shekels of silver."
Amen. Today in a message entitled "The Perils of an Unfaithful Man," we're going to see what happens when you look at a woman, what happens when you land a woman in the same way that you land a deal, what happens when you love a woman. And we want Christian men to know that they should pursue God and not women.
Amen. All right.
That they should pursue God and not women. The truth be told, in this life, the greatest destruction of a man that could happen to him is dealing with a woman. Mind you, in this text, the desires that Samson had were, I believe, could have been fulfilled God's way. Many times when we look at the life of Samson, we only think about Delilah, but there are two more women that were in his life. The first woman that was in his life was one that he would marry, but the Bible says that she was a Philistine. The second woman we see in his life, in Judges 16, chapter verse 1, is a prostitute. And then after that, it is
another calm on the sea. But what we need is a special word that will burn within.